Musicians in Bars Getting Beer. This is Stephen Leckie. Stephen, you want to talk about the Baritones?
Billy. Cheers with
cheers.
my coffee. Here
coffee.
We are, my favorite neighborhood in the city. We're in the Annex, Bloor and Bathurst.
And we're doing what Seinfeld does, coffees.
Yeah.
Comedians.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we just met, and literally 5 minutes ago.
Absolutely. Well, a couple of phone conversations prefaced the whole thing.
Yeah.
And,
sort of. Yeah. Yeah. I don't slot talking with you into phone conversations because I associate phone conversations with something kind of pleasurable. With you, not. Yeah. Yeah.
I sense I'm going to be laughing.
Yeah. So hey, here we are. Huh? We got, you know, summer.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
So
we don't have to. We don't have the Don Cherry isn't, you know palatable. Yeah, right there. Yeah. What's the last concert you went to, Billy?
Rush. Yeah, Friday night.
Rush.
Well, not
Friday
the last.
Night.
Actually, I went to Big Sugar on Sunday in the park.
Uh huh.
They did a free show.
Right. Did you like that?
Yeah, it was good. A lot of people didn't because it was reggae and folky and. It's not real loud Gordy Johnson all the time nowadays, which is, that's fine with me. I like it eclectic.
I saw Rush when I was a kid. I mean a kid. I saw them open, a few times as a adult, like around 15, 16, when they were with John Rutsey on drum.
Right now.
Whole different group.
Yeah.
It was like a... You know, close your eyes. It was like Led Zeppelin. It was a really good hard rock band, and well, everyone knows, I suppose. If you're already interested in Rush, I'm not overtly interested in them. But one show, since you mentioned them, that sticks out was when they opened at the first time the New York Dolls came up here at the Victory Burlesque, a burlesque theater that. There was a band here at the time called Mainline, you know.
Mendelssohn.
Yeah, Mendelssohn, Joe, all that. And that was when he was still, you know, his vitality was still focused on other, you know, promotions and things like that. But that was fantastic, seeing from Rush open for the New York Dolls. And nothing could brace anybody for the New York Dolls.
No.
That was it. You know, it's the thing, I think, when you don't always know. How could we, when we're truly a witness to history, a cultural history? You don't really know that for a fact. History, the nature, the beast that it is, dictates that it's something that stands a certain test of time, right? Like Francis Bacon, the painter, he was always, compliment it. He wouldn't use that word, but it's in that area. Praise it. My work in 50 years from now. You know. Marshall McLuhan said that it's 30 years. A generation is 30 years. And you're nodding. So I think so. You know. I've been witness, and you have too, to, concerts that really grabbed me by the jugular. You know, it was real, boom, 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 boom. But it just didn't stand a test of time, And then there's been, conversely, the absolute opposite can happen, And that ties in with the experience I had as a kid. I mean, a 16, 15-year-old kid seeing the New York Dolls. I knew I was seeing history. That was historic, what we were seeing.
Like, were you that. In your band yet?
Hell no. That was until I was 18. This is 15, 16 years old.
This was your inspiration?
Well, it wasn't my inspiration. It was a wit. No, it wasn't. It was, we're talking about an event. You brought up Rush earlier.
Yeah.
Rush opened for the Dolls. There you have two bands 45 years later, we're still talking about them.
Yeah.
Tells me their history, right? Yeah. Right. The thing with the Dolls is you really knew it was history. You really knew it was history because and thankfully with the internet, there's little that you can't find out, that any kid can't find out, just by hitting YouTube and seeing performances of them. The Dolls, when they were breaking that, are wonderful, great. And cool, I guess. I'm not a huge fan of Rush at all. But for academic interest of mine would be to maybe compare them when they had this John Rutsey, a different drummer, before they, Neil Peart brought in this lyrical theme, the science fiction theme that, it isn't there. The first album that Rush had is what their whole set was. Yeah, not anything to do with science fiction. No Tom Sawyer in spacecraft.
Well, Dave Grohl said at the Hall of Fame,
what did he say?
When did they get cool?
Well, that's funny coming from a guy as Dave Grohl. My God, Jesus, wow. Now, isn't that the beacon? Wow. I'm not, my bent isn't sarcasm, but boy, I mean, talk about I think Dave Grohl's one of the most uncool people I can think. So I find it funny that him saying that about Rush.
Good point.
No, it's not a good point. It's not. It's not a good point. Why do they have this all covered here? Well, we can't. We see this shit. All right.
So what is your inspiration?
My inspiration? What? For what? Art?
Art.
That's a... Jesus. No, that's a curse. That's a call. That's a terrible curse. I don't know if. The artist I love the most in music is Elvis Presley, but there's nothing in my presentation of rock and roll that would remind kids of Elvis Presley, but that's an inspiration. But I do art. I mean, I had a clothing store. I had an art gallery. Various endeavors. Anyhow, yeah, man. So yeah, you do your craft, because you have to breathe, to keep in line, to toe the line.
So when you were 18?
Started Vile Tones. Put an ad in the paper in Toronto. Said yes to the first three guys that answered it. I knew nothing about music, about doing it. All I knew is a memory bank from a couple of years at that time earlier of the New York Dolls, of a couple of Lou Reed performances, very flat-footed, the kind of show that isn't that really really makes you think, And then said yes to the first three guys, practiced, and then the third show I ever did in my life on the stage was at CBGB's in New York.
Third show.
Because I knew from getting the first two shows on my own to get them. It's no big deal now. This won't sound like rocket, particularly difficult now, but trust me, it was then. I realized what's obvious, and that the effort it took to get that show could be applied to another location. And wouldn't it be better, if I was good, to knock them between the eyes in New York City on a Saturday night than in my hometown? So I did. Talked Hilly Crystal into it. He gave me four days. And I went down, bummed a ride in a cool car with a couple of guys in Hamilton, and one of the guys from Teenage Head, but it was Nicky, their first drummer. Yeah, that's that. Anyhow, so that's all cool. And that, hey, you know, Billy, there was a time there where to me, it was a bit of a it was interesting to make a comparison on the Bowery and with this town here, and realizing that look that we, I think, identify with you know, punk, was bigger up here by a mile than there. They already had their punk, man. They already had it. Like the Ramones, Talking Heads, Blondie, Patti Smith. They peaked in 75. They peaked before 77, which is, you know, ground zero for punk. You know, teenage punk. Ground zero is 77, and they didn't have that. They had the gods there, of course, were the Ramones, but the Ramones had, they better have sounded good. They'd been around forever playing. So they didn't really have it. We're up here. There was that organic explosion, that really organic explosion where that sound that we all know now, you know, that you would identify with punk, which is just sped up rock and roll anyway.
Yeah. And so, what about UK punk? Did that?
Oh, well, you know, again, we got another world of information that isn't fair. I mean, isn't even. Information would take a month or 2 months. There's no internet. There's no way of knowing until the issue of Rock Scene or the NME or Melody Maker. You know, you'd go and get the British music magazines. But other than that, you'd have no way of knowing. Where now, kids know instantly. We can find out. We can find out what Danko Jones are doing right now in Denmark, or wherever they are, Sweden.
So where was your first gig in Toronto?
First gig in Toronto? My first gig was in, it was called the Colonial. Mm-hmm. And that was a spot that was ruled. It was synonymous with Ronnie Hawkins, the Colonial. And then
the band.
Well, that is a little more north, okay. Actually, Billy.
All right.
But anyway, north being northern. I mean Yorkville.
Yeah.
Yeah. But there's something kind of interesting because when I was a kid then. Plane, I wasn't thinking of anything other than my craft, my presentation, what I was doing. But I would, you know, it was a hip kid, you know, that knew enough that to understand that it was Ronnie Hawkins's little nest, and the band were the band that were there. And then all those years later, I played with. Garth Hudson from the band, which is on YouTube, you know. So it's nice the way that all happened.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That was the era.
So there you go. How, you know, so the circle, it won't go unless it's real. It's got to be, you got to have it the first time to create the link for another link to come in.
Yeah.
Me and Garth Hudson and Robbie Robertson, we don't have much to talk about if that didn't occur. Do you dig? So when we met all those years later to record a Bob Dylan song together, we had a starting point for our conversation. That's history.
Sure.
That's different than, you know, doing a gig. This is way off punk, but that's okay.
That's
it
okay.
Actually, it no, it's it is it is punk. It is punk. Sure it is.
It's raw. It's organic.
Yeah, and you mean that as I don't know. You mean yeah, as opposed to there's no that genre didn't have what? It didn't have Peter Grant and you know Kit Lambert and you know guys with deep pockets that were right. That's what we're talking about, right?
No formula.
Yeah, you know guys that kind of did do it and were. Got massive in there for that period was the Alice Cooper group, because Shep Gordon, their manager, wasn't, you know, he got his money through on his own. He didn't get it from a record company. Like they went out and hustled for that band, you know, the Alice Cooper band. But yeah, is that what we are talking of?
Hey, I don't know. We're talking a lot of rock here.
Well, Toronto rocks.
Yeah.
It's your show.
All I know about Cooper was Frank Zappa liked him when he drove everybody away that first game.
Yeah, we don't have to talk about Alice Cooper. Yeah, yeah. Zappa saw them and had them on his what was it? Straight Records, right?
Mm-hmm.
But Zappa was pretty square. He was pretty, according to the, a couple of books I've read, one by Alice Cooper, the first one by, Billion Dollar Babies. It's hard to get. It's out of print. Again, the internet, you could get it. And get it tomorrow, if you want. But in the there's a new one by Dennis Dunaway, the bass player. And, Zappa lost the Alice Cooper band. You know? You know what I mean? Like, he actually lost the Alice Cooper band in Toronto, here, when they played just down the road at the Varsity Stadium, the rock and roll show. That they agreed to the Alice Cooper group. Alice, the singer, Vince was going to take a pass. The band agreed to be the backup band to Gene Vincent. And the Alice Cooper band had done a show at that venue, that football stadium, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And that's when the chicken, came apart. Alice threw it in the air, right? The people watching this all know this. You got to give me something more to work with, man. I mean, Jesus, Murphy.
I liked what you were talking about before the camera
was
rolling. Too.
If it doesn't tie in, it's not.
It's, okay.
It's not a story. If it doesn't go, I know that. Yeah. I'm big on that. I think it's got to have. It's got to have the facts of a link, or it's not. It's not his. See, I don't like. Who cares what my opinion is?
You like the information behind the music.
I like the facts. I like the facts. I like the facts. I like the fact.
Well, tell me some of the stories
behind the music. Oh, no. I like the fact that the Sonics are a tougher sounding band than Buddy Holly and the Crickets. That's a fact.
Yeah.
I like that. The facts. You know? I love that I'm in vile tones. That's a better seat. You know?
That's a better seat than this one.
It's more of a speaking in speaking in metaphor, you know. Anyway, yeah.
You know, this
everything,
is...
everything is what? Everything is political. Everything is sure. Could be art. You know. I mean, we were talking before you started this on Francis Bacon, the painter, a little bit, or I was.
Yeah.
And time and everything. So. You better go, bro. You got to say shit or I'm going to go in a circle.
But, I will.
But it'll be more, you know what? It'll be meandering. We're going to lose as a Mensa. No, we'll lose the subtlety of intelligence and it'll veer into like they really won't know what I'm saying.
No, I get that.
You and five others.
Yeah.
But you're going to get a lot of people to watch this because I'm very... They know me.
Yeah.
If I throw it on my page, then you're guaranteed you're going to get a few thousand people.
Well, yeah. That's what we're looking at. And we're...
But if you don't, you know, we got to tie it in. I wouldn't give it too much air.
Yeah.
Too much air because it'll run away
with it. But that's life. I want you to run away with it. You talk about Shakespeare when you're just talking in sentences. You know?
Yeah, but I've been in this a long time, and this isn't, you know.
I hear you.
Yeah, this isn't a, you know.
So go on with what happened with the Vile Tones from the beginning. You want to talk about how you grew, how you got international.
I think left it at, you keep pausing from time to time on this camera, so I'm uncertain of where to pick the thread up from the conversation. But I'll pick up from this, and that is that. All I knew is when I, you know, went from, a badminton racket as a guitar or a microphone and had a real microphone, I knew this much. I'm not going to play anywhere north of Eglinton. And I didn't. I wanted Manhattan. Manhattan didn't mean you play some kind of strange circuit in Saskatchewan. Yeah. Or I don't want to be in a van with a bunch of guys. I don't want that. Not any longer than I needed. You know? So that was kind of... Thinking how much fun I had today with posting. I love Facebook. I like what people, you know, if it's interesting, if it's culturally, if it's got some merit, you know, if it's something that's truly original, think of that. That in itself doesn't come by a lot, you know. I'm not big on seeing yet more pictures of cats, you know. But anyhow, I posted a picture of the last week. Of when I had a an art gallery called Fleur de Mal, after Baudelaire's Fleur de Mal, Flowers of Evil. And that's what I was thinking of, having the cigarette. That's what I was thinking of. Missing the feeling of moving, of traveling. But not within the confines of a within a rock band. That's just an ouch. That was a rookie thinking. I remember telling I had romanticized this notion in my head about it, and I told that to Chris Spedding, who was working on a mix of some music of mine. And I had said, man, I'd love to just travel in a, you know, a van, go up and down England. He gave me a look that was really haunting. and I mean real adult and flat-footed. Like, are you? Do you mean that? I mean, I can't even imitate it. But it doesn't have to be like that. And hey, we're in an era. Like right around the corner is Lee's Palace, mm-hmm. right, Billy?
Yeah.
At Lee's Palace, I can't tell who's the band and who's the roadies. I can't tell. Earlier you mentioned Dave Grohl. If I saw Dave Grohl, I would pass. You know, I would pass. I mean, I don't. You can feel charisma. You can see it. It's a authenticity on the screen. Grohl doesn't have it. You know? And that's what's, I think, a kind of a thing. We've hit a snag culturally, looking for a new... their own Iggy. They need their own 19-year-old Mark Bowler. That isn't reminiscent, however, of Mark Bowler,
right.
Who really is laying out songs that have that bang a gong, you know, or fiddle the knot, boys are back in town, that kind of, you know, but their own, not looking in a rear view mirror, seeing if they got it down right, you know, that there is a. There is a hierarchy.
Is that lost?
Is that lost? Is that lost? I don't know. It sure hasn't shown itself here. This is just my taste, but keeping in mind, I had said earlier, who cares about my opinion? But that being said, it's been a long time since I had the feeling that it had come back again. Guitar, rock and roll in the face of, you know, Manic Street Preachers, Suede, and Oasis. That's not happening now. You know, we go around the corner. There's Lee's Palace. There'll be a lineup. You should take the camera there. You'd be hard-pressed to know the band from the roadies. It's really hard. I mean, it's... When I first saw it a few years ago, I thought it was a routine. I thought it was a gag, you know? But that's how strong I feel about it.
Is that just because everybody dresses like musicians now?
That's not dressing like musicians. That's dressing like... Dressing like musicians? Elvis Presley was dressed like a musician. You know?
That's the charisma.
Well, that's. I'm not thinking that everyone should, you know. The look. Why would anybody, you know, co-opt a look? How stupid would a kid look? With a black cowboy hat, a Maltese cross, a handlebar mustache, everyone would be going, why are you imitating Lemmy? And that poor kid who spent, you know, 4 hours in his bedroom nailing that look down, thinking he was original, walks out to be greeted by the Emperor's new clothes. You just look like you're imitating Lemmy. Anyway, so forget that. Forget the look. It's a, you know.
And then the sound. Everybody's imitating a sound.
The imitating the sound? What does that mean?
Derivative. Every musical form is based on some other. There's no new genre.
Well, I think that we're not making... Well, the facts are that the most powerful genre is hip-hop. The most powerful music, the biggest music, is rap. If we were in the States, that would be self-evident. We would know that. You know, it's shifted, and it's a long, you know, that didn't just come and go with the Beastie Boys. You gotta, you know, fight for your right to party. That's a whole generation. That's over 30 years. In America, we'd know that, you know. So there's guys like 50 Cent walking around with, you know, bullet holes in them. That's hardcore. And I don't even, you know, I don't listen to rap or hip hop, but that's a new genre. There's an invention. Again, I don't like it. I like it with a good, you know, two guitars, bass, drum, vocal, you know. But the facts are that what has been invented that isn't coming from Eddie Cochran, Gene Vincent, or Elvis Presley at all, not coming from that at all, is rap and hip hop. That's a fact. That's right.
Unique.
Don't you think?
Well, yeah, unique is important. Punk was unique.
Right. Movements, right?
Yeah.
Movements. Well, musical movements. That's different.
That's art.
Well, that's different when you a movement to just look. If you say you're an artist, you better, I think, remember you're throwing your hat into genius. You know? You're saying you're an artist, you better know. You know, and
does this count, what I'm doing?
Yeah, of course it does. Yeah, this is brilliant. This is significant, stunning that you wouldn't have done this. What's that?
You wouldn't have done it if it wasn't.
Say that again.
You wouldn't have taken part in this if it wasn't something that was substantial.
That's very true.
So that's how I know now.
Yes, that's very what you just said.
If you're here, and now I know this is art. It
that's absolutely
culture.
True. That's right.
How did you reflect culture? When you were 18, what did you see that you were? What knowledge were you trying to disseminate?
Oh, hell, I mean, you know, it was the... Well, for one thing, it was the flip side of what was the major status quo. It was as far away from disco and Led Zeppelin as you're going to kind of get, you know? We're in the middle of something. No, leave that in.
Leave it in?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. It's uncouth. I'll help you out, you know. But you're not, I didn't wake up hoping I'd run into you today. I hate to break it to you, you know. Yeah, the light's looking better on you now, Billy. It's looking good on you.
I'm not
it's
on.
It's bringing on... No, it's bringing out that cowboy quality you have. You got this Third Avenue thing going on.
Can I turn it?
Yeah.
I don't know what he's talking about.
Yeah, you do.
Thank you for that.
Well, hell, it's great you're doing this. And Seinfeld, who you like, you mentioned him, and is doing something similar.
A little bit derivative.
Yeah, and that's great. He, you know, he's getting really... He's a cantankerous kind of guy anyway. He's not a shy guy. He's, you know, when he's on, you know, talk shows. He's not shy. And I think he's aware that he's cantankerous. He's not trying to win you over. You know, he was saying in this era how incredible, and his show, all it is what the title is, just like the Seinfeld show. It was about nothing, but it was number one, you know, But he was saying how over, it's so touchy-feely, incredibly overly politically correct, that he sometimes finds it hard to say stuff. I saw him talking on an interview, and he asked his daughter, what did you think of this joke? Such and such happened, and the woman came in, and then blah, blah, blah. And he was saying about his daughter, he goes, she said, Dad, that's so sexist. And he's like, no, that was a joke. In fact, it was like not even close. I mean, you want sexist. I mean, it wasn't even close to Richard Pryor or, you know, Red,
sure.
Red Fuck. Anyway, yeah. Okay.
Times have changed. The politically correct.
You don't even know who. I mean, for all I know, you're like. What's your name? I mean, one year you're. I'm not even going to say it myself. See, a lot of self censorship, I think, happens now.
Yeah.
That's one of the things I dug with the Gallagher brothers a lot. That was a lot of it. But not just their music and how overt they were on, yeah, these are Beatle licks and you just turn them around and twist them and do this and you've got a catalog of hits. But you got to know how to, you know, execute it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But it was their bravado. It was the way they talked. They weren't self-censored. Maybe it was all the beer they were drinking too. I don't know. But but that's changed. Where you know you have to be mindful. You have to be mindful now in this era that we live in. This time in world, you know, history. I think. Okay, that's it. Like, here's rock and roll.
Show me.
Well, no, it's it. There's rock and roll, Sun Records. It's also Velvet Underground. Does it feel just like Jesus?
That's what the girls are looking for. Take your shirt off.
Right. Anyhow, Sun Records. That's where it all started.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's an example. You know, you can't even say that. But
I just wanted your smoke pack.
There.
I love that.
See how that, you know, in an era. Oh, I got better stuff than that for you, Billy. Oh, no. Here's when you've got, here's the best. What is this here? Yeah, this is, that's when you're like, that's like sort of having,
awesome.
No, but that's like a platinum card, platinum Amex. Okay? That's for longtime fans. You, Billy, I don't know you that well. But that's not to say that you don't deserve some welcome to the gang.
That's great.
Vile Tones candies.
I got Toronto Rock's fridge magnets.
Oh, yeah. You got that? Can you give me a couple? Can
you
I
got
have
them.
A couple?
These
oh,
are,
yeah.
These are for you, man.
See, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. That's something, you see? You do that effort. You do this. That's art. You see, you're an artist, man.
I try.
You're for real. You're not trying. You're doing it.
That's awesome.
It's hard. You're pulling it. It's not that it's easy, but it's the work for people, I think, that don't distinguish between easy or not, you know, dangerous or not.
Well said. Touching. Jeez. Stephen Leckie, musicians in bars getting beer. We're getting coffee. We're doing what Seinfeld does.
It's great meeting you, Billy.
It was awesome meeting you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.